this week at Connection Life Church.
The Word, we understand that the Bible is very clear that those things which we see are all temporary. It's the things we see that are temporary. Nothing on this planet is permanent. All temporary. Some of us have had high school sweethearts who just turned out to be temporary. Later on, they just vaporized in the wind and were gone in a poof. You thought you had me, and now you don't. My great golf drive, which I can drive it over 300 yards, I've got witnesses. But, unfortunately, that great golf drive is very temporary. And it often vanishes into thin air, very rarely to be seen again. My golf drive, which I can see sometimes, is also temporary. I've seen great meals cooked on the fire. Oh, my mouth starts watering. Come on, somebody. You get hungry. You have a physical manifestation because of the sight of this food. But I promise you that too is temporary. And if you leave it on the counter too long, or if you leave it in the garage refrigerator too long, you go out to grab those leftovers and it's not quite so appealing because it's only temporary. The Bible is clear that the things on this planet are temporary. In reality, what we don't see is ultimately what lasts eternally. Downtown Sunday worship here at Connection Life Church in downtown Salem, Oregon. We're so blessed that you're joining us on our broadcast today. We got a great service for you. I'm starting a brand new series on hell. I know it's kind of scary sounding, but here's the thing, is God, He actually prepared hell for the devil and his angels who turned away from Him, and we have a choice. We have a choice to either turn to Him or turn away from Him. We're going to talk a little bit about the realities of hell, and then in the later on in the series, we're going to look at the realities of heaven and what a joy heaven's going to be. We know you're going to be blessed. Once again, thanks for joining us. And hey, listen, if you're ever in the downtown area, we'd love to connect with you in person. We meet every Sunday morning at 10 a.m. right here at 210 Liberty Street Southeast, across the street from the Grand Hotel. We'd love to join with you in person. You can get all of our information, all of our times, our events, our schedules at our website, www.clcsalem.org. That's www.clcsalem.org. We want to connect with you. And hey, if you just need something to pray about, you want us to pray with you, or if you want to connect with us with maybe a question that you might have, just reach out to us. We'd love to hear from you. All right? God bless you. Now let's join our service already in progress.
Yes. It's so good to see everybody here this morning. Welcome to Connection Life Church. It's good to see all of you. It's good to see some faces that we haven't seen for quite a while, at least in person. It's so, so good to have everybody here this morning. I would also like to welcome those watching on the World Wide Web or watching on TV this morning. It's so good to have each and every one of you with us this morning. We hope you feel blessed this morning. How many of you are just excited about the fact that your Redeemer, the person who redeemed you, the person who paid the price for you, is not dead? He paid the price and He died. He paid the price and He experienced death just like we do as human beings. But He's not still there. He's alive. He's alive. He came back from the dead. He not only redeemed you, He not only paid the price and took your place, He's alive. He is alive and powerful and active today here in your life. He is available to you today still. And I haven't sang that song in a long time, and man, it just started stirring up something in my spirit. Man, that was an exciting song. How come we don't sing that more often? Well, praise God. I just wanted to read something to you this morning. It's Psalms 42, starting in verse 1. It says, as the deer pants for flowing streams, so pants my soul for you, God. Now, if you think about a deer, if you think about some of these wild animals that live out in the wild, they sometimes travel for miles and miles and miles before they find water that's drinkable. They know what's drinkable and what's not. And sometimes they travel for a long time. They go through a lot. Sometimes they're chased by predators, and they're panting, man. They are thirsty. They are like bone dry inside, waiting to get that water. And you know what? If you're here this morning and you feel a little bit dry inside and you are panting and saying, Lord, I need some refreshment. Well, get ready, because your Redeemer's alive and he's here this morning, and he's here and he's available to you, and he is ready to just think of the largest tidal wave about to crash over you this morning, because he is here and he is about to do so. In prayer this morning, I felt something. God is here in such a real, miraculous, amazing way. And he wants to just move through here and sweep through your life this morning. So just open your heart, open your mind. Be ready to receive all that he has for you this morning here in this place. So I'm going to go ahead and pray so that we can get right back into worship. Lord, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for this morning. Lord, we thank you for a new day. Lord, a new day to worship you, to praise you, to bring glory and honor to your name this morning, Lord Jesus. Lord, we thank you for your presence that was already here, that is here and available to us. Lord, you were here this morning to meet us here in this place. Lord, we thank you so much. Lord, we thank you for your redeeming love. Lord, we thank you for the blood that washed us and made us clean, made us new. Lord, we thank you that you rose again from the dead. Lord, you are alive and you are powerful and you are available to us. We have only to reach out and grab a hold of that, Lord Jesus. Lord, we thank you this morning. We say, come and have your way here in this place, here at this service, here in our lives this morning, Lord Jesus. Lord, we just thank you for the work you are about to do here in this place. Lord, I thank you in advance for what you are about to do here in this place. Lord, you had an agenda. You knew. You know what you're about to do here. Lord, if we could just be open, open our minds, open our hearts to receive, Lord. I thank you this morning. Have your way. In your name, amen.
I want to know you. Let your spirit overwhelm me. Let your presence. Oh, let it overtake our hearts, oh God. I want to know you. Let your spirit overwhelm me. Let your presence overtake my heart. I want to know you.
I want to know you. Let your spirit overwhelm me.
Yes, God.
Let your presence overtake.
Come and overwhelm us, Father God.
I want to know you. Let your spirit overwhelm me. Let your presence overtake
my heart. I want to know you. Let your spirit overwhelm me. Let your presence overtake my heart. I want to know you. Let your spirit overwhelm me. Let your presence overtake our hearts this morning. Yes, God.
be renewed spiritually, Father. God, that you sharpen each other. God, that you know, iron sharpens iron, Lord. So God, help us to sharpen one another. Help us to be renewed in our spirit. God, so that as we come back to our churches, God, as we come back to the ministries that you've called us to, Lord, God, that we don't grow weary in well-doing. God, that we can be faithful to serve the way you've called us to serve. So God, I pray for a blessing as we leave to go this weekend to the coast to just be renewed and enriched in your presence, Lord. God, we just also ask, Lord, that each one of the members and the visitors today, Father, God, that your presence just overflow our homes and our families, God. God, that anything that the enemy may be using to come against us, God, Lord, we come against that right now. We stand upon your promises and we ask that you cover our homes with your blood and you cover our homes with your protection and your presence, Lord. God, so that we can stand upon what your word says. God, that you are our provider. You are our healer. God, you are all that we need in our homes and in our families. We ask that you strengthen those relationships right now. God, you cause fathers to be fathers and mothers to be mothers, Lord. God, that there be an honor that raises up within the family and the children to honor their parents the way you've called them to. God, and we just ask that you bless our families today, Jesus. God, we also lift up Sheila Lawrence to you, God. God, she's the Sheriff's Office Commander in the Institutions Division. God, she is responsible for the operations of the jail and the work center. God, we ask that you give her wisdom as she leads. God, we ask that you give her blessing as she leads. God, that in all the decisions that she makes for those who she works with, Lord, God, that you bless her and you give her wisdom in it. God, we just ask right now for just your blessing over this time together, Lord. I know that there's many who are sick in body, and we just want to lift you up. If you want to just stand and let's just gather around each other. I know we want to send out a special prayer for Wendy today. Wendy Ray, she's been battling sickness for a few weeks now. And we just want to stand with her and stand with you for healing today. God, we thank you for your healing. We thank you for the blood that you shed on the cross. God, that the death that you defeated so that we could be healed. God, you bore the stripes so that we could be healed. And we stand on that, Lord. And we ask that you send your spirit forth right now. And you touch Wendy, you touch the other, those who are in the body who are sick. God, those who couldn't be here because they were sick. God, and we just ask that you renew them right now. You bring everything into alignment. Anything that's out of order, you put it back together the way you've called it to be, Lord. And we thank you for that. All right. Let's just go on and have our kids come for Kids Church. We've got an amazing group of kids in this church who love Jesus. Go on and come to the middle. We have some visitors today too. Go on and join us. And let's just reach our hands out to them. If you want to just reach your hands out and let's lift them up, that God will bless them during their class time today. God, we thank you for these young leaders. God, we thank you for these young ministers. These young people who are going to grow to serve you and just honor you in their life, and they're going to share your word with others. God, bless our teachers today as they are in charge of these little ones. We thank you for them. We thank you for their faith, and we thank you for the example that they set for us, Lord. Bless them as they go to their class today. All right, kids, go ahead and merge. You can go on and join Sharia at the back.
Aren't they? Come on, let's give our hands our kids a hand clap offering as they go. We want to give them a hand clap offering because they're awesome. All right. Well, praise the Lord. I just love being in the presence of God, don't you? I'll tell you, last night we were in Portland, Oregon, and there are some people that are just hungry for God. It's been a long time since I've been in a service that was that packed. If some of us were there leading worship, and there were no seats left. People were lining the walls, standing along the walls because there was nowhere to sit. And then they just opened up the platform so that people had a place to be, and the platform got full. They were sitting with us in the worship team, and then they just kept coming. There's about 15 to 20 that were gathered around each door that led outside. They were standing outside every door, and the lobbies were completely packed. I mean, you could not walk. If you had to go to the bathroom, you're in trouble because you couldn't even get to the restroom. It was that packed. But God was moving there. A lot of people were delivered. A lot of people were healed. A lot of people were just blessed. When you're hungry for God, guess what? He'll show up. When you express your hunger for Him, He will show up. We just got to get hungry, guys. We just got to get hungry. We need to press in for the Lord and desire more of Him than anything else. Amen? Well, we're starting a new mini-series today. First of all, it's just good to see Bishop Pratt and Judy. It's always an honor to have him in service with us. It's been a few weeks, and so anytime he's in service with us, we just want to honor you, sir. Thank you for being with us. He's got a lot of churches to go visit, but when he doesn't have to be anywhere, this is where he is, and we appreciate that. So thank you for being here, sir. We are excited about Pastor's Retreat. Pastor Kevin Pemble will be bringing the word next week, and it's going to be a fun time. So make sure that you're here. Be blessed. Our pastors will be out being enriched. It's Pastor's Enrichment Weekend, and we're going to be enriched. So thank you for making it possible for us to be there, and we love that. So we're starting a mini-series that is going to be broken up every other week. So next week we'll have Pastor Kevin, then I'll start the second part of this series the week after. But we're talking about hell. Now, I know that sounds a little scary. That seems a little scary when we talk about hell. Let me just make it straight for you, okay? Let me clarify something. It's not going to be super scary. Okay, I'm not going to dress up in ghouly costumes and everything like that. I thought about having all those make this great set up here to look like hell, and then I thought that'd be a little awkward. So, you know, we're just gonna go into some details of what hell is about. You might have heard the story about a man who left on his tombstone after he passed away, and his tombstone said this to any person walking by, and it said, "Consider, young man, as you walk by, as you are now, so once was I. As I am now, you soon shall be, so prepare, young man, to follow me." Well, now that sounded pretty deep and profound, but someone took a knife and carved their own little addition to that on the man's tombstone and said this, "To follow you is not my intent, unless I know which way you went." You know, so, you know, we got to know where we're going. The Bible teaches us that life is not all that there is. After death, there is still life. There is a eternal existence that takes place after this life on earth. Today, we'll talk a little bit about the one eternal existence, and that is hell. In a couple weeks, I want to give you some good news that there is also a heaven. Heaven and hell are very real. Both are real. And we're going to learn a little bit about the position of hell today, all right? Would you stand with me one last time as we go into the reading of the Word? We like to honor the Word because in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And we want to honor Him today, so I'll be reading out of the book of Luke, chapter 16. Luke chapter 16, starting in verse 22. It says, "So it was that the beggar died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And being in torments and hate, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. Then he cried and said, 'Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame.'" Verse 25. "But Abraham said, 'Son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted, and you are tormented. And besides all this, between us and you, there is a great gulf fixed, so that those who want to pass from here to you cannot, nor can those from there pass to us. Then he said, I beg you, therefore, Father, that you would send him to my father's house. For I have five brothers, that he may testify to them, lest they also come to this place of torment. Abraham said to him, they have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. And he said, no, Father Abraham, but if one goes to them from the dead, they will repent. But he said to him, if they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded through one who rises from the dead. Father God, I thank you for your word. Lord, I thank you for the reality of our future. God, I pray right now that you would open our ears and our eyes. Lord, that we would receive that which you are speaking to us today. God, I pray that out of my lips would only come your words that come straight from the throne. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Thank you. You may be seated. See, as we read the word, we understand that the Bible is very clear that those things which we see are all temporary. It's the things we see that are temporary. Nothing on this planet is permanent. It's all temporary. Some of us have had high school sweethearts who just turned out to be temporary. Later on, they just vaporized in the wind and were gone in a poof. You thought you had me, and now you don't. My great golf drive, which I can drive it over 300 yards. I've got witnesses. But unfortunately, that great golf drive is very temporary. And it often vanishes into thin air, very rarely to be seen again. My golf drive, which I can see sometimes, is also temporary. I've seen great meals cooked on the fire. And oh, my mouth starts watering. Come on, somebody. You get hungry. You have a physical manifestation because of the sight of this food. But I promise you that too is temporary. And if you leave it on the counter too long, or if you leave it in the garage refrigerator too long, you go out to grab those leftovers and it's not quite so appealing because it's only temporary. The Bible is clear that the things on this planet are temporary. In reality, what we don't see is ultimately what lasts eternally. For example, the Bible speaks clearly that in the days we reach heaven, there will be no sickness. We don't see that here on this earth. But in reality, our eternity is no sickness forever and ever. No crying forever and ever. No more sadness forever and ever. What we don't see right now is what's eternal. The fact that we will have eternal joy unspeakable that's only full of His glory. But on the flip side, what we don't really see right now is that there's also an eternal torment. That is what's eternal. Heaven is eternal. Torment is eternal. The life that we live on this planet is just beginning. The life that we live is just beginning. And the life we live on this planet is just the start. It's like the warm-up for our eternity. It's like the first lap around the track of our eternity. Our entire existence on this planet is like only page one in your book that goes on and on and on. You know those books. You read these books, and if you're like me, who's not a huge reader, I like to read only things that really pique my interest, like leadership. That's about all I like to read, and the Bible, of course. But give me another long book like Gordon Conwell does, and it's tough, Bishop. And it's tough. They assign you these books that are this big, and have you ever read into it? It's like, oh, I'm getting into it. But then you're like, taking a look at the back, like, how many more pages are there? Just goes on and on. And our life on this planet is like the very first page of a book that just goes on and on and on. Our forever, we don't see. Only what we see here on this planet is temporary. Let me ask you a question. if I was reading your book, or if someone on the street was reading your book, where would that book lead them to? What would they be reading? Would it be a book of eternal gruesome and horror and fear? Would it be one of those books that are scary to read? Or would it be one of those books that end with that happy love story that everyone can enjoy? Because all of our lives are like a book. It's a book that's being written every single day. And guess what? There are people reading your book. There are people that are flipping through your pages, saying, wonder what's going on with them today. Do you hear about their episode last week? They just blew up on someone for no reason. I don't know what's going on in their life. And people are reading our book. They're reading all about us. And what will the end of our story tell? Will it be joy, or will it be sadness and sorrow and fear? I want to clarify today that this whole message is not a hellfire and brimstone message. Listen, I grew up in Pentecost. I know what those sound like. In the old days, there was a lot of those messages, and that's not what this is. This message is not about a turn or burn situation. I'm not trying to scare you into heaven and scare you out of hell. But I am wanting to give you a message of truth. I want to give you a message of hope. That this message is really about the ultimate love of God and a sacrifice that He made. This message is about a choice that you, my friends, get to make. See, God loved us so much that He gave us a free will. We're not robots. He gave us a free will. He gave us a choice to live with Him or to live separated from Him. So don't look at hell as just a place of eternal punishment. We talk about that a lot, and a lot of our biblical translations talk about an eternal punishment. But I'm here to tell you today that hell is not just an eternal punishment. See, it's not really an eternal punishment if you choose to be there. If I look at a child, and I'm trying not to embarrass my kids as much, so I'm going to refrain. Any child. It could be any child. If we look at our children and we say, Jimbo. I'm using that name because there's no Jimbos here. Jimbo, you've been bad. I need you to take a timeout in the corner. And then what infuriates a grown adult more than this? If the child looks at you and says, well, I wanted to sit in the corner anyway. Oh, did you now? See, what kind of punishment is it if we send our kids into a punishment, but yet they wanted to go there anyway? They were choosing that anyway, right? See, God has given us a choice. And hell is not just an eternal punishment. It's a choice that we make to either, we make the choice to either be with Him or be separated from Him. And to be separated from Him, there's only one place that He is not. And that is this place of torment. See, many people today reject the idea of hell because they don't understand why, if God is so loving, why would He let anybody go there? If God loves us so much, why would He let us go to hell where it's so bad? Well, there's a reason. It's because of choice. It's because He allows us to choose. See, to run from God is to run to the only place where He isn't. But to run to God is a much greater future. Do you remember when we used to get mad at our friends, and especially when we were younger, we'd get mad at our friends, and I hear little kids still doing this today. If your friend doesn't make you happy, or if your friend upsets you or does something you don't want them to do, there's a lot of young kids that they have this punishment for their friend, and they say to their friend, if you do that again, I'm not going to be your friend. As if that's their punishment. But see, this is the opposite of what God is doing. God isn't telling us, if you do this again, I'm not going to be your friend. If you do this again, I'm going to leave you. That's not what God's doing at all. He's doing exactly the opposite. He's saying, listen, my son, my daughter, I want you to choose to be with me. And no matter what you've done, I've already paid the price. I've already died on the cross. I've already washed you free from sin. Now, please, choose me. But it is your choice. So it's not a punishment that you're separated from God. It's a choice that you've separated from God. It's not him saying, because you've sinned, you can no longer be with me. It's him saying, because you've made that choice, then it saddens my heart that we're not as close as I want us to be. See, it's not God pointing his finger, saying, if you do that one more time, you're going to burn in fire. No, God's not up there doing that. It's not his will nor his desire that anybody perish in eternal torment. That's not his desire. And you know how we know this? Because he paid a sacrifice that probably none of us would have paid. See, I know that it's his greatest desire that we don't spend an eternity in torment, because he paid a hefty price so that we didn't have to. Now, if we choose to go after that, then that's on us. That's not on him. But so often, we want to put it on Christ as, why are you punishing us so bad if you love us so much? We all know as parents what it was like to spank our children. And of course, there's a universal common statement that we all made right before we disciplined our child in such a manner. And we all told our children, listen, my son, my daughter, you need to know, this hurts me more than it hurts you. I wish you didn't choose the way you chose. God is up there telling us, this hurts me more than it hurts you. Because if you choose to be separated from me, then it saddens my heart. Because it is forever. So what is hell like? If it's forever, what is it like? Well, we read in verse 23 in the beginning that he was being tormented in Hades, which is hell. A lot of us would read it as Hades or Hades. And, you know, it's, he said, from there he lifted up his eyes right from his torment. There are many Christian churches even today that are denying the reality of hell. The Christian Universalism movement, they believe that after serving their sentence in Gehenna, all souls are reconciled to God, and then they can be admitted to heaven. By saying this, what they're suggesting is that hell isn't forever, that you just must serve your time, and then you'll be admitted into heaven. Unfortunately, many Christian churches are becoming so seeker-friendly that they've shied away from the realities of hell because they don't want to scare anybody or offend anybody. They only want to preach a happy, happy, joy, joy message, and so they're steering away from the realities of hell. Now listen, this is a church here that we want to be friendly to everybody that walks through the doors. We want everybody who graces us with their presence to feel comfortable in worship. I'm not here to scare anybody. I'm not here to condemn anybody. I'm not here to judge anybody. We want to love on people where they're at, in the condition that they're at, so that God might move in them and do the work. So am I a little seeker friendly? Well, I'm seeking to be friendly. Let me just put it that way. But if we get so seeker friendly that we lose the grip of reality, then we're missing the truth. And people need to hear the truth. I watched a lot of videos as I was studying for this message. And I was going to show you one, but for the sake of time, I didn't bring it in. But there are people on the streets who literally don't know about hell. They know about God. They believe in God. They go to church. But they know nothing of an eternal hell. Many people are asked, do you believe in heaven? Oh, yes. Going to heaven? Oh, of course. Do you believe in hell? No, not really. Because this day and age, our culture only wants to please people, ears. But let me share with you that the reality of hell is just as real as the reality of heaven. In a national poll conducted several years ago by USA Today, 67% of American adults said they do believe in heaven. What that tells me is that 23%, or almost a fourth, one out of four people, don't believe. Less than 25% believe that they would go there, and 25% believe their friends will be there. Oh yeah, it's okay, because my buddy's going to be there too. We're going to kind of hook up when we get down there. Upon arrival, some of the men came to see him, and I'm talking about a chaplain. There's a chaplain who was reporting to duty, and upon arrival, some men approached the chaplain and asked him this question. They said, sir, do you believe in a literal hell? And the chaplain replied that he did not. This was the chaplain. He did not believe in a literal hell. Their response to him was, well, we are going to ask you then to resign. And of course, the chaplain, what? Why? And they promptly answered him and said, well, if there is no hell, then we don't need you. And if there is a hell, then we don't want to follow you. And he resigned that day. Why? Because hell is just as real as heaven. The Bible teaches that hell is a very real place. And the concept of hell was not invented by the church as a way to scare people. Now the church has taken an approach, conveniently, to see the realities of hell and try to scare people into heaven. But can I tell you that the Bible is very clear, there is only one way to the Father, and that's through Jesus Christ, his Son. We can't scare anybody into heaven. They have to have a personal relationship with the Father themselves. See, in our parenting classes, we used to be able to scare kids into obedience. Now, you'll go to prison for that. Right? And let me tell you something. The church used to be able to scare people into heaven. Now, people will no longer come. So I offer you this truth. That as much as you believe that there is a heaven where we will spend eternity with the Father, I would offer you this truth, that there is also a very real hell where people will go if they choose to separate themselves from God. See, the Bible says in Matthew chapter 25, starting in verse 32, it says, all the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. Then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Now see, Satan rebelled against God. And hell was literally prepared for those who, like the devil, chose to run from God, chose to separate themselves from God. So what do we know about hell? Well, it is eternal, as we've talked about already. Also, it's a very bad place. Now, I know that I don't mean to make light of it, but I can't express to you enough how bad this place is. I could put on a scary mask. I could change the color of my skin to black red. I could put on fake nails that look like they can scratch you. But nothing I can do could do any justice to how bad this place is. We read in verse 23 that the rich man was being tormented. He lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. Then he cried and said, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me. Send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame." Now, in order to understand hell, you have to understand what the word hell means. See, it occurs 23 times in the New Testament, in the King James Version. And there's basically two words that describe the picture of hell. The first word is used 12 times, and it's the Hebrew word Gehenna, which I explained earlier. It comes from the words Gehi, which means valley, and Hinnom, which means sorrow. You put these two words together in the Hebrew, and it means the valley of sorrow, the valley of Hinnom. And do you know that that's a real place? The reason they called this the valley of Hinnom was because it was where everyone in Jerusalem would dump their garbage. And in this valley came a very, very bad stench. Very bad. I would imagine it was similar to the stench that comes from my garbage can right now. As I've told you, I've got a little drama in my garbage can. Today I have decided that I'm going to call them tomorrow and say I need a replacement garbage can. And I'm sure that the stench coming from this valley was as bad as that, if not worse. This is where all death was laid. Garbage, dead animals, everything was taken there to be burned. The second word that was used 10 times in the New Testament is the Greek words Hades. Hades comes from ha, meaning not, and edo, which means to see or perceive by any of the senses. And here we have, from these two word pictures, what the Bible describes as hell. Did you know it's actually a physical place of suffering? The passage says that in hell, the rich man was in agony because of the fire. This word in the Greek is odunao, and it's better translated sorrow or anguish. And imagine being physically in this place where the King James describes it as torment. And I got to tell you, the word torment is a lot more scary than just physical pain. Because torment literally is ongoing. It's forever. Torment means you just can't get away from it. You can't escape it. See, there's a difference between hurting yourself and tormenting yourself. I remember a time where I was skiing. My nephew had a dislocated knee not too long ago. So much pain. I remember the pain he was in because when I was skiing, I've told this story before, I hyperextend my knee. I landed wrong off of a jump and my knee bent completely the wrong direction, and that's very painful. What's interesting is that at the time that it happened and I landed and created a garage sale all the way down the mountain, I had skis for sale, I had poles for sale, I think my goggles went flying, I mean, everything was gone. And by the time I reached the bottom, when you experience pain like that on this physical planet, sometimes you have so much adrenaline and so much shock that you don't feel anything. Now, unfortunately for my nephew, that wasn't the case with him. He actually felt it. But for me, I got up. I was like, oh, man, I was all wiped out. I had snow everywhere. I had to gather all my things from on the mountain. But I wanted to continue skiing. Well, I felt the pain the next day. And I had to put a full air thing on, brace, leg brace, cast, whatever it was. I thought I was going to die. That's how bad it hurt. I couldn't move my head without my knee being in excruciating pain. But that was just a little injury that lasted a little while, and then I went and skied another day. But here's what happens. Compare that to someone who lives in chronic pain every day of their life. There's a difference. See, I could burn myself with a fire, but I'm not going to continually go stick my finger in the fire because that would be tormenting myself. And people will go, why do you do that to yourself? Right? I'm not going to go continually hyperextend my knee like, oh, that was fun. Let me do that again. Because people would think you're crazy. You're tormenting yourself. Do you see the difference between torment and just getting hurt? See, I'm not trying to describe hell as a place where you're going to get hurt for a long time. Hell is a place where you're going to be tormented forever. Have you ever burned your ear with a curling iron? Guys, have you ever burned your neck with a curling iron? Now, let me ask you something. For those of you who have, do you intentionally go into your restroom and say, that was fun, I'm going to try burning my neck again? Because if you did that, that would be just awful. You would be tormenting yourself if you just continuously did that. So we don't want to live in this eternal torment. It's a place of physical suffering where you can't escape it. You can't escape it. And what's really sad is that it is truly us tormenting ourselves because we chose it. We chose it. Matthew 13:40, again, it says, therefore, as the tares are gathered and burned in the fire, so it will be at the end of this age. The Son of Man will send out his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all things that offend and those who practice lawlessness, and will cast them into the furnace of fire. There will be wailing and gnashing of teeth. This is a torment that you can't escape. It's a torment that's just as real as the blessings you will find when you choose Christ. Hell is a place of relational suffering. What do I mean by that? Hades is a place of complete darkness and loneliness. In this story, there was a rich man there who only wished and prayed and begged, would you send Lazarus to cool my tongue with just the tip of his finger in water? And then he was told that there's a separation. There is no relationships here. There is no gathering. There is no communicating and hanging out and relief from your friends. There's nothing. And I don't know if you know what it's like to feel lonely. I don't know if you know what it's like to maybe be locked up in jail or in prison and have nobody. And if you have been in prison, have you ever been in isolation where you're the only one? You know, being in the cold and having an uncomfortable bed and having to go to the restroom in front of people with a toilet not covered and all of that stuff is nothing in comparison to the relational suffering that takes place when you have nobody to go to, nobody to talk to, and nobody to relate to. And this place, Hades, is a forever, an eternal place of relational suffering. It's a place of emotional suffering. Several times when Jesus talked about hell, he said it was a place where there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth because their emotions are so messed up, they know not what to do. They just weep uncontrollably. It's as if you were buried alive in a tomb. And you have nothing you can do and you just go crazy, scratching your way to nowhere, weeping and gnashing of teeth. Imagine the emotions and the eternal sadness that never ends. See, when you think about Hades and this place of emotional suffering, anyone who is separated from God forever, they're going to wish, because they will have a conscious memory of what it is that sent them there. You don't forget. And there will be an eternal reminder of your choice, that you separated yourself. You'll remember all of a sudden your life will flash before your eyes, and you'll remember the times when someone came up to you with a Christian tract and you threw it away because you thought it was silly. Someone came up to you and invited you to church, but you thought you didn't need church. Someone came up to you and invited you to pray with them and you didn't think it was real. Someone came up to you and said to you, you know, God has a lot of grace, but you need to choose your eternity. And you chose to do your own thing. And this emotion, wishing you could take all of that back, will stick with you forever. Say, Pastor, I thought this wasn't supposed to be a turn or burn or full of fear. I'm not giving you the turn or burn part. I'm not giving you the fear part. I'm giving you the truth, and then you have to make a decision. I'm not trying to scare anybody. But I do want you to know that the church today has watered down the reality of hell so much that when I watch video after video after video, there are countless number of people that you can randomly pull out in downtown Salem who will know nothing about the reality of hell. You might say, well, does it matter? If they choose heaven, does it matter? Absolutely it does. Absolutely it does. Because we don't choose without all the information. God has given us a choice between good and evil. He's given us a choice to either be with him in eternity or be separated from him in eternity. And people need to know the truth so that they can make an honest choice. It's not an honest choice if you only give them one option. It's not an honest choice if you only give them one description. I could go to the ice cream parlor today. The guy could help me. Super nice guy. Says, hey, you want some ice cream today? Yes, I do. What would you like? We've got vanilla. We've got vanilla. Or you can have vanilla. I'm telling you, vanilla is the bomb. And I say, well, guess I'll have vanilla. Not because I wanted vanilla. Not because I think vanilla is the bomb. Because it's the only choice that was given me. See, our eternity is based on the choice we make in relationships. It's relationships. Do I choose to have a relationship with the Father or do I not? That's the choice we make every day of our lives. The Bible says that when we wake, we should renew our mind daily. You know what that tells me is I need to choose him every day of my life. There will be circumstances, there will be things that will cause me to choose something else. There will be other options. And that's how I know that my eternity with the Father is going to be so grand and wonderful, because I know that of all the options that were presented to me, I chose him. Today, I choose him. Tomorrow, I choose him. You know what hurts? Is when your son or daughter chooses to go somewhere else. If I can have the worship team come back up. It's no secret that we've got students that are aging out. Aging out of kids' church, aging out of youth church. They're getting older. We have a lot of seniors that have already graduated. And it's no secret that I myself have kids that are getting older, two in high school now. And when they graduate, you know what is hardest on a father than anything? Is when your child decides they need to go somewhere else. How do you think our Father feels when we choose to go somewhere else? If the amount of pain that I feel just thinking about my kids going somewhere else is that real to me, how much more real would it be for God who says, I've sent my son for everyone in John 3:16, that whosoever, everybody say whosoever shall believe in me shall not perish, but have everlasting life. In this one passage, he gives everyone on the planet a choice. And he says, this earth is not your home. This earth is temporary. But your home will be forever. And in this one passage, he says, I now give you a choice. Here's the thing, I'm going to send my son. And he's going to die on the cross and he's going to pay the price for your sins. This day forward, you will no longer have to live with guilt and shame. It's your choice. You can choose to believe. He said, whosoever believes shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Now you could choose to not believe. You could choose to separate yourself from the Father, in which case, just as there's an eternal heaven, there's also an eternal Hades. It's up to us. Which way will you choose? You say, Pastor, that's a silly question. You know we're all Christians in this place. I don't know that, actually. Because Christian, to be a Christian means to be Christ-like. Are you Christ-like? Have you chosen this morning, once again, say, Father, I choose you. Give me the strength to choose you every moment of my life. Tomorrow, will you choose him again? The next day, will you choose him again? The next day, will you choose him again? And then the moment where you have another option. Someone said, hey, I've got a deal coming up later on, and we're going to go to the bar, and we're going to do this, and we're going to go there, and we're going to go this, and oh, by the way, my friend's bringing some really cool enhancement stuff, whatever you want to call that, right? Whether it's alcohol, drugs, whatever, right? The nicest way I can put it is my friend's bringing some enhancements. Will you choose him again? Over the life your friends are offering you? Because hell is very real. And we need to choose him every day. This isn't a hellfire brimstone message. This is just a message of truth.